So I, yes, do various things, and I teach a course about art in the public realm in the Roski School. And you're welcome to take that course, teaching it again next semester. But I am thrilled to be here today to, I'm tangled a little bit. Oh, I can't take off my jacket. Hold on a second. I just realized I better leave this on because the microphone is attached to me. Sorry about that. That's okay. That's okay. I'm good. I'm thrilled to be here today to talk to you about what I would call art on the move. So, or I was saying to Professor Banerjee as I came in, maybe we could call it planes, trains, and automobiles, and how artists get involved in those things. But increasingly artists are involved in their cities, not just putting art in museums and in galleries. And I have organized a number of exhibitions, not just in museums and galleries, but also in the public realm itself. So I'm going to show you a little bit about what I've done. I'm going to show you some projects that I think are interesting here in LA and elsewhere, where artists have really gotten involved with some of the things that I know you all work on, which is the kind of transportation and public sector in terms of how people move around cities. So we can talk about how those things intersect. So some of the work, a lot of the work that I've done has been about organizing exhibitions that are temporary out of doors. So this is a Calder piece at City Hall Park. I'm frozen though. Let me just see what's happening here, why I'm frozen. There, okay. So this is a Calder exhibition that was organized at City Hall Park, and what typifies most of the work that I've done is that all of these exhibitions have been temporary, so they themselves have been on the move, and rather than permanent. So there are, of course, many permanent commissions around every city. Great Calder work permanently in various locations, but the work that I've done has basically been temporary. As a kind of extension of exhibition space from museums to out of doors, idea of kind of a museum or gallery without walls. So we typically think of public art as sculptures in parks and plazas, like this. Even monuments. Artists, contemporary artists, tend to try to make a bit of a spoof. So this might look like a typical war monument, but this is actually work by a contemporary artist called Keith Edmire, who decided to make two monuments to his two grandfathers who served in the war. In a way, a commentary that this is the everyman, a personal connection, as opposed to, you know, the kind of mythic military figure that we don't know. We don't know these people either, but he did. So in a way, you know, a very traditional sculpture, but, you know, with a kind of twist on how to approach it. This is a work that was by Central Park. I was the director of the Public Art Fund in New York, so a lot of the work that I've done is in New York. This is not distant from where there have been in the past. They are under question back and forth, where the kind of carriages, horse carriages, line up by Central Park, and this is a work by a British artist, Sarah Lucas, kind of diminutive pony, and it's carrying a load of concrete courgettes or zucchinis. We also think about artists making murals. There's a whole tradition of murals, from the Siqueiros mural, which is up by Alvaro Street here in our own city, to fantastic WPA murals all over this country. But even contemporary artists are interested in the idea of facades and murals. This is an intervention of an artist called Sarah Morris at such an iconic building, Lever House, in New York. It was there for about a year. You can see it's actually going all the way through all of the passageways of the building. Basically a 20,000 square foot temporary mural. So artists themselves are very interested in public spaces. They're interested in getting engaged with spaces of cities, not just in New York. These I just happen to show because there's some I've commissioned and worked on, but here in LA as well. Just a couple more. You are probably used to seeing mimes kind of standing in various places, making performances. This is an artist who decided to make those mimes solid. So these are bronze. People were quite kind of fooled by them and would go up to them and kind of tap on them to see if they were actually, you know, real mimes or, you know, fake mimes or, you know, and leave money for them, these performers. But these performers were actually bronze cast. Here we have Che Guevara, Caesar, and the blue woman is from a Dali painting. So he was inspired by these mimes that he had seen on the Ramblas in Barcelona, and in turn turned them into kind of casts. In this area, there are a lot of mimes also, so you could see the kind of life figures and his version. I've worked on projects at very kind of high trafficked sites like Rockefeller Center. This is a work by Anish Kapoor, the British artist, piece called Sky Mirror, which reflected the city on one side, concave on one side, or convex on this side, reflecting the city and the traffic, concave on the other side, reflecting the sky and the building. He kind of saw it as a landscape painting in motion, and of course, as the clouds moved and went by, just as the traffic went by on the other side, the whole city kind of reflected in this mirror. Work by Chris Burden, an LA-based artist who we know from the lampposts out in front of LACMA. This is his work, which is made of over a million individually cast erector set pieces. He had long before, he's passed away last year, but long before this work, cornered the market on erector set. So he has had to stamp these out himself in aluminum. In order to be able to make his own pieces. He was inspired by Rockefeller Center itself as a skyscraper, as a building. This is a piece called What My Dad Gave Me. His father was an engineer who worked in this building and actually was inspired by that, and as an artist has been very interested in the history of cities, as you know from the piece in front of LACMA, which gathers up the lampposts and the kind of urban furniture from LA and puts that there. So just a couple others to give you a sense of all the various artists that I've worked with. This is just a few, but this is a work by Sarah Z, a Chinese-American artist who wanted to really think about the relationship between public space and private space. We all have had the experience of going by an urban situation and you kind of peer into somebody's house or apartment and you see the light flickering there and you kind of feel like you're on the street but you're looking into somebody's domestic setting. Here, she wanted to bring that kind of corner down to ground level. And when you look inside, there's a whole kind of arrangement. She's known for her incredible installations of lots of bits and bobs of pieces of domestic parts. And people were just kind of mesmerized. It was a really incredible kind of moment to have people feel like this project was there on the corner there by the park. So, in a way, engaging all forms of transportation and its signage. I worked on a project called the New York City Waterfalls with the artist Olafur Eliasson, who's a Danish-Icelandic artist. And this was in 2008. It was at four sites in New York, in Manhattan, Brooklyn, and Governor's Island. You can see those white signs are kind of indicating the four sites. And he was himself was very inspired by the signage around kind of transportation in the city, wayfinding, which inspired the way we noted and advertised the piece. But this is the work. So four man-made waterfalls, each 100 to 120 feet tall, so that's equivalent to a 10 to 12 story building, erected in the East River. One was standing on this leg of the Brooklyn Bridge. And later I can answer you all the various questions about the umpteen permits that I had to get in order to make this stand there. There were more than 25 permits, city, state, and federal, including, you know, you don't want to know, but the Parks Department, the Transportation Department, the Sanitation Department on the city level, Department of Environmental Conservation, et cetera, on the state of New York level, Corps of Engineers, blah, 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 on the federal level, because everything had to be taken into account. So there were four of them, one on that leg of the Brooklyn Bridge. It actually didn't touch the bridge because the bridge is historic and protected. One on this pier. One on another pier in Brooklyn, which this is the area that has all been redeveloped now into the Brooklyn Bridge Park. So at that point, this is what it looked like. And now you've probably seen or seen pictures of. It's a complete transformation of Brooklyn Bridge Park and green space and recreation space. And these were meant to be seen by boat, from the bridge, by bike, by foot, from all different vantage points in the city. There are a few places, and this is the one at Governor's Island, there are a few places where you could see all four at once, but the artists really wanted you to go on a journey through the East River. At that point, the development on the Hudson was, we know about very well, but the East River was less developed. There was really a kind of thinking about, by the artist, how can we, why do we turn our back on the river so much, the river being historically a form of transportation around the city, but, and now again, increasingly seen as not a divider between Manhattan and Brooklyn and Governor's Island, but a connector. So, anyway, this project was organized by the Public Art Fund when I was the director, and it, just to give you a few of the facts and figures before we get on to kind of airports and other spaces, it cost $15.5 million. It was up for 4 months. It generated $69 million for the city of New York. That $15.5 million was raised privately by my organization, which meant a lot of lunches and dinners with people to get them to give. People donated everywhere from $5 to the largest donor, $5 million, which was a corporation. And it was an incredible challenge. The whole project was realized within 2 years from the initial sketch on the back of an envelope from the artist to opening it to the public. There were incredible challenges. The reason it happened really was because of great partnerships with a construction company, Tishman Construction, and with the City of New York, and also with now non-existent, but at that time, the Circle Line, which provided the ability for people to kind of maneuver around the city. And so building those partnerships was, as well as, you know, managing all of the permits was my job and raising money. So anyway, this always leads to a million questions and I'm happy to answer them, but transit. So I love this picture. This is a sculpture I stumbled upon in the Copenhagen airport this summer. And I just find it hilarious. These two bronze figures kind of overseeing all of the movement in the airport, in the departures area. I think a lot of people might not even notice them there, but they're there. And once you do notice them, you kind of can't stop noticing that this is exactly where you go and stand to kind of see what's happening below and to kind of look for people. And I found myself standing there looking for the person who I was separated from, who couldn't hear his phone ringing while I was, going through the check-in and everything. So I find this to be really interesting. It's in a way kind of rare because one of the things we know about airports and work in airports is that it's usually a little bit more iconic. I mean, this almost kind of disappears into the background. The typical work, this is Calder's flight from 1961 at JFK Airport. Usually art is put in airports to kind of give it a sense of the identity of a city and is really used as kind of an introduction to the city. We have a whole program here in LA. I'll talk about it in a moment. But in a way, the art in the airport and these programs that have increased over the last 10 years, especially since 9/11, have really been about giving a kind of sense of identity of the city. Most of the art in airports is also suspended in order to be out of the way. So this Calder early piece is more typical than those two figures kind of standing there, although you can see they're standing by the banister, so they're kind of not in the middle blocking up the road. And that's one of the things that artists really have to take into account when they're asked or considering working in any kind of transportation site is how not to be what we call an attractive nuisance. Because especially in a transit site, we're very aware of not putting things in the way. As we know, JFK Airport has been renovated and that various terminals have been changed and redone. That Calder piece was originally in the Saarinen terminal, which is no longer used as it was originally, and it's found a new home, but it still remains in the airport. This is perhaps the piece that kind of kicked off the idea of art in the airport in the modern age. This is the Chicago O'Hare Tunnel, Sky's the Limit, and I'm just gonna take a kind of switch over here. If you don't know the piece, If you haven't been through the United Terminal, let's see if that's too loud. This is it. It's this underground passageway, right? And I don't know how many of you have experienced this, but it connects two parts of O'Hare via United Airlines. And not only is there this kind of light show that kind of keeps people moving, there is the United theme song, okay? And that is a part of the kind of branding of United in the airport. And I think this is one of the first pieces. This was put there in the 80s to really kind of bring a sense of how airports could be redesigned with a kind of more user-friendly, calming device, let's just say, to them. And this has been a big part of that branding. Also, I think, you know, it's about moving people through, kind of moving people along those escalators, which they have to do naturally anyway, but the lights and the design of the space do that as well. Okay. Let me turn that off. So, go back. Sometimes it's maybe a little less calming. This is the Denver airport. I don't know if anyone is from Denver or has passed not just through it, but outside of this. This is on the outside of the Denver airport. This is Blue Mustang by an artist called Luis Jimenez, and it was commissioned in 2008. It was meant to represent the spirit of the American West, but it has been quite controversial in that it is either kind of loved or hated, and it's kind of you know, insane looking, this blue horse with the red eye. But this is the kind of iconography of Denver. And airports have gone through this kind of idea of how to brand themselves and how to use art to kind of do that. LA itself has gone through a kind of new art program. So the LAX participates in the Percent for Art program. They have a 1% for art. By comparison, San Diego Airport has a 2% for art. You know, I'm sure you guys have talked about these Percent for Art programs, whereby a percentage of construction money is dedicated toward art and permanent installations. And so the LAX has adopted it. This is these new three pieces have come about because of the renovation of the Tom Bradley Terminal. So, sorry, this first one is the rendering for a piece by Bal Nogas Studio called Air Garden, which is a curtain-like suspension made out of approximately 90 miles of metallic chain. And the colors appear to change based on where you're viewing it from. So there's this kind of sense that as you move through, not unlike what's happening in Chicago, but a little bit less mechanically, it is shifting its appearance. This is a piece by Pei White, an LA-based artist called Woven Walk, and it is a suspended tapestry by the Customs and Immigration area. There you can see it a little bit more closely. And this is a piece by Mark Bradford, also an LA artist, called Bell Tower, and it is in the mezzanine area above the TSA security screening area. And that is a place where both ticketed passengers and the general public who come to pick people up can see it before going through the security control. And this is modeled after a medieval bell tower, although it also resembles the idea of a jumbotron in a sports arena. So he created this out of 712 panels cut from salvaged plywood and posters that had been collected from the construction site itself. So he used those materials that he found during that construction at LAX and kind of brought them back into the site. Mark Bradford is an artist from LA who is known for looking at the materials on the site. This is a piece he did in New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina, which was, again, kind of salvaging materials. It's like an ark. And it's in the lower Ninth Ward. And he used those materials to kind of symbolize this salvation and the Ark. And he's had gallery exhibitions as well where his paintings are using kind of posters and street materials in the canvas. And just one more in a different space of LAX. This is in Terminal 3, a piece called Elevate by Joyce Dowell. And this piece is there surrounding passengers as they go through the security checkpoint. And it is made of, you can't see it so well here necessarily, but it's made of paper airplanes suspended in flight. And they're formed of Japanese paper imprinted with excerpts from the Geneva Convention and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So she's using this kind of fragility of the paper and the paper airplane with the kind of loftiness and heaviness of the words from the Geneva Convention and the Declaration of Human Rights as a kind of sense of bringing this to you as you are standing there waiting to go through the security checkpoint. So I think within all of these projects, you have a sense of different approaches by artists to thinking about what you might think about as you're moving through these spaces. Some people might notice these pieces and some people might not notice them at all. And that is something that we kind of know about art in public spaces. A little bit more you can see looking up. And just so technology isn't completely omitted, this is a piece by an artist called Jorge Oswaldo and it's called LAX Poppies. And it's in the terminal's meet and greet area. And this is in case you forgot to bring flowers to your loved one. You can actually do it digitally and take a photo and post that with the hashtag LAX Poppies. So that is bringing us to the modern age. Okay, just moving from one form to another. Union Station, I'm sure, spent your time in moving in and out of. Such a fantastic space that has gone through an incredible renovation. This artwork actually has been there since 1995. It's toward the back where the metro and the trains kind of connect, if you haven't seen it. It is a multi-part piece by Mei Sun, was originally from Shanghai, but she's lived in this country for many years. She got her BFA from UCLA and an MFA from Otis Art Institute. And it is this piece which has a river bench, as well as these pieces of crockery and bottles that were discovered during the excavations at Union Station when the station was built. And she's looking at these artifacts as referring to the original Chinatown, which of course was displaced when Union Station was built. So she's really looking at the kind of history and incorporating that into her work of public art. And then there's also this aquarium, which was intended to replicate LA River's freshwater environment. And etched onto the glass, you can see a little bit of the etching here in the front, are faces of some of the Indian and Latino settlers, as well as references to indigenous fish and that would have been in this area. So she is really trying to connect the history of this site, including what was there, the prehistory before Union Station was built, by making this piece, which is permanently there. And you can see connecting the bench on one side and the aquarium on the other side is this, are these tiles embedded in the floor with symbols of fish and flora and fauna and symbols. And it's a very kind of successful piece there in that area that has been there now 20 years. This is also part of the project. This part in collaboration with an artist called Richard Wyatt. The mural is also looking at the kind of origins of LA, and the idea being to focus on people who have lived in this area. This is an 80-foot long mural that contains images of Native Americans and settlers to the LA Basin, as well as contemporary Angelenos. So the idea of these three, kind of the fish tank and the Chinese crockery, as well as this, is really to kind of look at what was there underneath this site to begin with. This, of course, is permanent, a permanent installation. I think that the more we kind of look at it and study it, it shows this kind of layered history. And some artists are very much interested in that kind of history.
Also, in Union Station, if you've noticed as you're going to and from the trains, there are these light boxes now, which host photos. They change maybe about once a year or so, and they are kind of exhibitions thematically grouped. So last year, there were exhibitions of portraits along the passageway, these by an LA artist called Sam Komen. And these by an LA-based artist called Catherine Opie, kind of looking at the people and the infrastructure of the city within the space of Union Station. Oops, sorry. And then currently, there is they've changed that, and currently the focus is landscape. And so all of the photos and the light box going up and down the passageway are looking at the landscape of the city. So I think this is a really good use of this space, and as you go there, you can kind of explore it and see kind of like an exhibition on the way to and from the train. Okay, so trains. Trains don't escape artists. Doug Aiken, who is an LA-based artist, recently took over a train. He started in New York and ended up in Oakland by way of various stops along the country, including LA, and calling his project Station to Station. And you can see this public art project was sponsored by Levi's. And what he imagined was that he, for the month or so that he traveled across the country, he had artists and writers and musicians and all kinds of creative people on this train with him. And they would go from city to city to city, something like 10 or 12 stops. And at each stop, they would roll out their tents, and they would kind of set up a creative environment that the public could engage with. So here they are in their first stop in New York with their tents. And inside each of these were artists had created installations and performances, and as they went from place to place, they found hosts for themselves. So here they are hosted. I think this might be in the Philadelphia Museum, and they engaged with local community groups. Here a high school band. Here they are. I'm not sure where they are here, but you can see they kind of set up shop as they went and had performances, and this was how they engaged the people of these various locations. Here in Santa Fe. And you could, as somebody living in that area or visiting that area, you could in many cases go for free, or in a few rare cases buy a ticket. This included Union Station. One of their stops was Union Station, so they rolled into town. This was about a year and a half ago, and set up a huge festival type atmosphere. I don't think I have time right now to show you a little film about it. If there's time at the end, I'll roll it. But one of the things that I think is interesting is that there's actually now a residency program on Amtrak for writers. And this is separate completely from Doug Aiken's project, Station to Station. But one individual, I have a little track about it. I heard about it on NPR. One individual he did his best writing on the train. And so he actually contacted NPR. He contacted Amtrak. And he worked with them to set up a residency program for other writers, creative writers, to be able to have time on the train. And Amtrak now offers this residency where writers have private sleeping cars with a desk, a bed, a window, and they can watch the American countryside, and they get onboard meals in the dining car, and they can write. And so I think it's a really interesting way to think about how transportation can actually be a kind of place for creativity. So trains and metro are part of this. This is actually our own expo stop right here. This is a work by Robert Flick, who was a professor in the Roski School for 30 years. This is a piece called On Sundays. And he just retired, but a couple years ago, this piece was erected when the expo line opened. And Robert Flick is a photographer who, for his entire career, has documented Los Angeles and cities from his car. So I think it's very fitting. He has set up various devices in his car, and sometimes he also commuted from San Diego to LA for part of his career, where he would set up devices so that he could photograph out the window. And so this is up there, and you can see that it is serial photography, and they show, the photographs show, really the changing of the neighborhood from the vantage point of the street level. So it's a really interesting piece. The photos are baked onto these enamel panels, and it's a permanent piece there. And I think it's a really nice kind of relationship between his work and realized in this kind of transportation hub. Now you can see another one. And in a way, it's a real document to this neighborhood, because this piece actually documents this, is about this neighborhood, which is why it's so fitting for this expo site. And just a couple others. So this is a piece that actually is no longer there. You've probably passed by it in your time. It was on Wilshire Boulevard. This was a work by Jim Isserman, who was commissioned to do this piece for the facade of the Metro Facility Customer Center in 1987. It's been taken down now because the Purple Line is going to go through here. But you know, various artists from LA and elsewhere have been, you know, really integrating their work with the Metro over, you know, decades now. And I think the Metro has been one of the interesting customers for and commissioners of artists in our city. Just to kind of look back, of course, New York has been doing this for a long time, as have other cities. I always like to ask people where they think the art is here. So, of course, there's the historic tiles and decor here around the Eagle and the 14th Street symbol. But also Mary Miss is an artist who likes to intervene into spaces. So the work is the red bars here and the kind of pointing out of details, calling attention to things that you might otherwise overlook. Mm-hmm. And so when she was asked to do a work in this station, that's what she wanted to do, was really call your attention to things that you might otherwise overlook. Just a couple from New York to kind of show you the difference between New York and LA. New York has 280 works of art permanently in their subway system. So in a way, you can kind of call it a museum underground. This is a work by Roy Lichtenstein, the Times Square mural. Elizabeth Murray's Blooming at 59th Street. See there. A lot of the works in New York are, of course, mosaic, because the tile is part of the structure of the underground. This is a work by an artist, John Kushner, called Four Seasons. Four Seasons Seasoned. And you can see the different seasons. That's at 77th Street. Saul LeWitt, Columbus Circle. Vito Acconci, this piece called Wall Slide, and you can see that it looks like the wall is kind of sliding down. Artists get very creative. And this is a recent, one of the more recent pieces by Leo Villarreal. He is the artist who put the lights on the Bay Bridge, different kind of transit that he was interested in. But this piece changes, the lights change as you're in the space. And this is at downtown in Bleecker Street. So I think the underground in New York has really thought of this as a kind of permanent set, lots of permanent sites for ongoing commissioning. And with a new train line opening, there's two new train lines opening right now. They're already very involved with commissioning artists for different stations. Very briefly, London, newer to the act. Actually, while I was working in London, this was one of their first projects. It was a collaboration I did with them, actually, while I was working in the Serpentine Gallery. This is work by Cindy Sherman, the photographer. The Platform for Art in the London Underground realized at a certain point that 3.5 million, there are 3.5 million journeys every day on the tube, and by 2020 there will be 4 million journeys per day. And so certain platforms are disused. This one happens to be disused. The train doesn't go right there, but these arches become completely viable spaces for art rather than advertising. So Cindy Sherman was asked, she'd never done outdoor work before as a photographer, and she, we asked her, we approached her and said, you know, would this be interesting to you? I was working on this exhibition with her in the museum. And she said, yeah, I'd actually be really interested in putting some of my women there, kind of for people to pass by and to see. So this sparked a whole series of projects. This is work by a Japanese artist called, the artist is called Chio Ashima, and the work is called City Glow. And you can see the kind of nightscape and dayscape. A Brazilian artist, this piece is called Peace and Love, and she's Beatrice Milhouse, and she's really inspired by the colors and forms of Rio, and she liked how that kind of brought kind of life to the underground in London. And all kinds of sites started to get used and looked at by a colleague of mine who was then running this Platform for Art program in the London Underground. So rather than put advertising in all these places, artists would start to take over. So you can see here a few interventions. There in the kiosk, wrapping the train. This is the same artist who had done the kind of customer station in Wilshire Boulevard for the MTA. This is actually one of the projects of theirs that I find almost the most charming is doing the tube maps themselves. So each one of the covers of the tube maps were also seen as a platform for an artist to work on. And this is completely mobile. It goes in your pocket, it goes in your bag, it goes in your purse. So artists were consistently asked to design and put their artwork on the map. This is one of my favorites by a British artist called David Trigley. Of course, spoof on this, all the lines coming together, you know, in his mind, the kind of spaghettis. And I'll just try to show you a few more things. I know David is probably eager to come up and chat with me or discuss, but I just want to talk about buses a little bit, just not to forget this form of transportation. This is a work by Barbara Kruger. She wrapped this bus. This is actually, it was organized by the Public Art Fund a bit before I was the director there. All sides. Barbara Kruger is an LA-based artist. She actually teaches at UCLA and formerly lived in New York. And much of her work is looks like this. All of her work looks like this in terms of black and white and red text. And these kind of overlaid declarative captions where she's basically imploring you to think about what you do and how you act toward others. So these buses for a while rolled through New York and have rolled through LA, including some work on billboards. And this was on Western for a while last year. And yeah, it's always kind of interesting when you kind of do a double take when the work is, you're driving down the street or walking down the street and you see something a bit unexpected. John Baldessari, another LA-based artist, in this bus resembling a school bus. English and Spanish, perfect for Angelenos. But I also wanted to point this project out that not only took into account, I think artists and have not only taken into account what's on the outside of the bus, but also what's on the inside of the bus. And I find this to be a really important point. That what's on the outside of the bus or what's on a billboard, you know, is viewed by one audience, but what's on the inside of the bus is viewed by, or on the inside of the metro station or on the inside of the metro car is viewed by a different audience. And as you probably know, advertisement on the outside of a bus is a lot more expensive than the advertisement inside of a bus if you were going to pay for that space. And that's because it's a different demographic, riding the bus versus driving outside of the bus. I think, you know, it's worth kind of noting in our head who is seeing this. So far I've been talking about different forms, but I haven't necessarily been talking about audience. And we don't always know who the audience for this work is, which is one of the challenges. We say the audience is everybody and the audience is anybody who passes by. But when you're actually doing something in a contained space in the bus, you can actually, or in the metro, you can actually know a little bit more who is seeing this. And I think that's worth thinking about. It's one of the pitfalls of working in the public realm is that you're not necessarily sure who you are reaching. Okay, just a tiny bit more. So this is a project from the 80s when the Public Art Fund started working in Times Square. Hotly contested space right now in terms of how much of that is going to be actual public space. But an artist called Jane Dixon started to realize that the LED boards there could be fantastic for artists. This is, and so she set up a series using those LED boards that at that point in the 80s were all the latest technology. Now, of course, they look very antiquated. This is work by Jenny Holzer, her first LED piece. She's an artist who, like Barbara Kruger, uses text. And you can see that the work was completely integrated into the site, including, you know, the ticker, feed of news, the traffic, and everything else. We have Keith Haring, New York artist, who use these kind of cartoonish figures. Artists making political comments. And so in time, this furniture, urban furniture, changed. Artists started to use video instead of LED. Swiss artist called Pipiletti Rist. And these, it was interesting because these boards were given over to artists for a portion of the time. Part of that was tax benefit, part of that was do good in the city, part of that was good collaboration. But artists got a lot of exposure and people got to see things that they normally wouldn't be able to see. This is a kind of quintessential and important piece. It only was there for a short time, but I wanted to just point it out. It's by a very important artist who passed away in 1996, Felix Gonzalez Torres. The art is actually the black billboard. Integrated into the space, it's right in the West Village, and it was done in 1989 to commemorate the 20th anniversary of the Stonewall Rebellion, which happened in that same square. And he notes there a number of dates and names and places that are significant from personal and public perspective, so kind of markers. It's not a timeline, but they were pieces of information that he felt were important to call out to people at that place, at that time, on the 20th anniversary. So I think this is how billboards have been able to function as kind of markers. I'm just bringing you all the way to today. This is the High Line. The High Line has used the sides of buildings as kind of billboards, huge billboards that people walk by. This is Ed Ruscha, an LA-based artist who made this work there in New York. And maybe I'll stop with that so that we can have time for questions. But I have run through quickly various forms, planes, not the actual planes, airports, trains, metros, buses, billboards, and things seen everywhere in between. I think artists are very interested in the public realm, and artists are very interested in how their art can completely infiltrate the city. And these are just a few examples of that. I don't think it is coincidental that these platforms give them huge visibility, but also give them the ability to kind of think about themselves as part of the city.
For those of us who know about the High Line, know that it is an extraordinary engine of economic development. And reminds us that parks like other parks in New York, like Central Park, all the way back to the 1850s and 60s, have been those. But in some sense, there's this intriguing, what is the public realm piece here? Because many of these are private buildings that are then being brought into the public realm by artists. And so two things real quick. One, we often talk about the cultural economy. And in some sense, when we talk about the cultural economy, we often forget the word culture is at the beginning of the term cultural economy. And what Professor Steiner just took you through is this extraordinary role of art in the city and how we imagine the city, how we experience the city, and how, in some sense, we interact with the city, and how, in some sense, we activate spaces within the city. And I'm going to come back to that in a second. But one on the negative side, or if you will, on the controversial side, it is also used in some ways to pump the economy. It is to pump the developments around it. And that's just the beginning. There's a lot here that's fun to talk about. This whole idea of how do we develop city identities or place identities, you might say, because in some sense the High Line is in the greater New York, but it now has its own identity tied to Tribeca. The idea of how we create spaces in the city is often tied to these large-scale public projects. And as you know, one of the reasons that we as a city and as an area have supported light rail at enormous expenses, in some sense, to connect ourselves and tie ourselves together, but it also allows those spaces along there, which fight very hard for a metro stop, like the fight that happened in Limerick Park, to allow them to, in some sense, create new identities or to reinforce identities or to establish identities. So the first thing is cultural economy. The second thing is this idea of identity. The third thing is there's a lot in here about scale. And it's really quite lovely to think about scale, not just of the art, right? So the waterfall, this giant 10-story waterfall, versus those two figures in the Copenhagen airport that are probably 5 feet, 6 feet tall. I mean, that kind of scale, but also the scale at which we use the art. So I was recently in Stockholm and in the subway, and they have this just giant art project in the Stockholm underground. And it is an amazing subway system that's very efficient, very effective, and you come in and you have all of this stuff that you get to look at, and most of the time you don't have time because the thing's so efficient. But it's there as part of the way for us to deal with the scale, right? The scale of moving across large spaces of the city, the scale of the subway terminals. I don't know if you've been in the Tom Bradley, but it's a big building. These aren't the little, this isn't the Pan Am terminal of the 1960s. And increasingly, we're building in larger and larger scales. And in some sense, the art gives us some sense of, you know, wait, this place is enormous. Maybe that will help me understand it, tolerate it, deal with it. And so it's not just activating space. In some sense, it's actually allowing us to use space or to deal with spaces that are very uncomfortable. How many people been in the United hallway at the Chicago airport? I mean, it is this amazing thing where it's a long way, right? That's why they did it. It's a long way. They don't want you to think about how doggone long they're making you go to get to the airplane so you can go away. They're just trying to make you think, okay, this is fun. Hey, we got music, we got light, it's a good thing. It's like a ride, you can talk to your kids. And so in some sense, there's this interactivity that's very powerful, I think.
I think there's also just one thing to add. Yeah, I think there's also, especially with airports, there is a function of time, and a lot of the development of art in airports has increased since 9/11,
not that only people, that it's an uncomfortable place and that people are increasingly, you know, having to tolerate being there, but also that the amount of time people are spending in the airports has increased since 9/11. And so that is part of the acknowledgement of spending 1%, 2%, more percent of money in these places because of an acknowledgement of how much time people are spending in airports, which has increased.
The other thing that comes through very well, for those of you who've read Margaret Crawford's Everyday Urbanism, there's this idea of the large scale, very formal institutional projects, all the way down to the smaller scale in the environment in which you live on an everyday basis. And so art doesn't, we often, I think, dismiss art as this, you know, plop art in the middle of the plaza, or the institutional art in the foyer of the city hall, or the public realm art in the airports. But that's only part of this extraordinary infiltration of art into the routine of our lives. And I love the way that Professor Steiner gives us not just the big ones, but also the little ones, the sort of ways that artists and institutions have begun to try and play with this interaction. The Barbara Kruger bus, I think, is a great example of, you know, you're walking along and this bus goes by and it's the fifth bus you've seen today, but it doesn't look like any bus you ever saw before. It's yelling at you in some sense, you know, get involved with schools or do something or think about civil liberties. And in that sense, it really changes the conversation. I'm gonna end with, I love the way that Union Station's are really, as people have taken my class know, a really complicated place. It was the second Chinatown after the one across the street. It was a leveled Chinatown. The Chinese were a stigmatized group within our society, marginalized, and then almost obliterated and moved to another site. So it has a very complicated racial class history. It also is, in some sense, got an intriguing transportation history because it's one of the great last train stations in America, because in some sense, trains were done. You know, we're going to fly everywhere. Everybody's going to be in a helicopter. There's going to be no need for a train. And so in that sense, it was often viewed as this legacy of a previous age. And one of the things that's reminded us, not just the art reminds us of that history, but also reminds us that in some sense, it has been reborn as a new part of the urban realm. And in some sense, one of my favorite examples is, if you saw it or didn't see it, right now there's a lot of talk about the industry's new hopscotch, which is where you get in a limo and drive around and hear an opera. The previous example was their opera inside Union Station on the book Invisible Cities. And they used the entire space of Union Station for their opera, and you had headphones on that were having the opera come to you as you walk through the space. And so in some sense, art's reinventing Union Station as we as planners are reinventing Union Station in a new time of transportation. So that history and the future come colliding together in the art that is there in a very nice way. Thank you very much.
Artists are fascinated by the city, and not just as, oh, this is a big place to work, but actually how they can change the city. And one of the things that I would just point out is that the mayor has just announced that he is going to appoint an artist to work in the city to help solve traffic fatalities. And it is very particular that it is an artist who is going to be appointed in this position. I think it's a one-year fellowship or something like this. And it's not to create art projects. It's to help solve what is seen as pedestrian problems because there have been a certain degree of fatalities that are intolerable in this city. And I think that is very interesting. And that is, I think, the intersection of my work and your work and, you know, where these two things come together in terms of creative forces and looking at how to deal with what is right before us. We could look at the extraordinary realm of, let's call it creative marketing and super advertising, which is some of it still, some of it moving, some of it digitized, some of it, you know, transforming before our eyes, some, you know,
all of this, which is taking place inside transportation vehicles, which some of it is very personalized, which affects what you actually hear in your car, which has affected wrapping buildings, like entire buildings. So you walk down the street and you kind of can't place what you're seeing because the entire building has been wrapped by something. Wrapping boats, some of the boats in the East River have been completely wrapped and branded by Target so that Target can be seen, going up and down red advertising floating up and down the East River. I think that the possibilities are actually endless. The question is, to what degree do we want to see this, happening, and to what degree may that or may not be controlled in certain cities and environments?
There are really brilliantly beautiful designed ads.
Absolutely.
But in some sense, I would argue that way too much of our lives are consumed by looking at screens filled with ads and not enough by art. And the blurring between the two creates all sorts of havoc in the city. As you know, there's a whole literature about this idea of the spectacle city and this. So my favorite billboards were, the Mac Center out in West Side did this fabulous project, about 5 years ago, where they actually took over 20 billboards and had Jenny Holzer and others do
basically
really
an exhibition on billboards.
Beautiful art on billboards. And as you drove around, you could drive around and see them. They give you a little map. And as you did this, you were reminded, there really is a difference.
Right.
I mean, there really is a difference between a great piece of art on the billboard and a great ad on the billboard.
Yeah.
Because one of them is, in some sense, trying to illuminate the city for you, and the other one is trying to get you to spend money.
Actually, this is one of them. I have a couple pictures from that show. So there was a show called, organized by the Mac Center in LA, called How Many Billboards? So yeah, they took over a number of billboards in the city. That was one. Here's another one. And these were artist-designed billboards throughout the city. There was recently another project called Manifest Destiny that was organized by an artist, and it was 100 billboards across 10 cities across the country, across the 10 freeway. So those cropped up city to city, so from, I think, St. Petersburg, Florida, went through the South to San Antonio to various places in New Mexico and ended up in LA. And so this artist, in turn, commissioned other artists to do 10 billboards at a time in these different cities. So there are these examples of kind of billboard exhibitions where you start to see, yes, there might be a difference between this. This is a kind of classic by an artist called Larry Sultan. Which is commenting on LA and the history of LA and, our former economy here, ongoing economy here, advertisements. Yeah.
And as you may know, probably don't, one of my doctoral students, Bryce Lowery, and I wrote an article for the American Journal of Public Health in which we showed that billboards often are not randomly selected in our society. They are the worst of the billboards, or the worst messages of the billboards tend to be focused on minority populations, poorer populations, and they tend to have a more intense number of billboards to deal with. And so in some sense, this has consequences beyond just the spectacle of the piece. Beyond just distracting us from our everyday lives. There are things going on out there that we want to try and move around as planners or as artists.
Yeah, there's also somebody here, I think her name is Elizabeth Solano or Saldano, who's in Dornsife.
Yeah.
And she has done a lot of work on billboards and actually sued the city, right? And she may have talked to your class, but she's done a talk that Tridib and I have heard. Very interesting in terms of looking at the history of billboards in the city.
Tell me if I'm wrong, but I have the feeling that most of the artists' names you mentioned were women.
Half and half, not all. It's actually shifted over time. I mean, there was a time when there were artists who worked in museums and galleries and artists who worked in the public realm, and these two things didn't meet. It was in the 70s and 80s, it was seen as two completely different career paths and two completely different tracks. And while there are, you know, some artists who only, it only makes sense to make a painting that shows in a museum, and it only makes sense to make a public sculpture that, you know, the intention is only to be outdoors, increasingly this line is more blurred, where artists are fascinated by different kinds of opportunities, different kinds of platforms, and different kinds of audiences. So the division, the hard division of saying I'm only an artist who's interested in the kind of commercial realm or the museum realm, and I'm not interested in the public realm, this is blurring. So I don't think we can make the same divisions anymore.
But would you suggest that public art was more open to women in the earlier days?
It might have been in terms of, there was certain forms of public art that were developing in communities that I think were more open in general to artists who had been kind of closed out of traditional forms of what we, of the canon. And that included women, it included more diversity, it included others. So perhaps. I do think in the 80s and the early 90s, there were a number of women artists who had very strong messages, Jenny Holzer, Barbara Kruger, et cetera, and that work actually lent itself for a certain kind of public messaging. And so that kind of interface made sense. But I think some of that is partly the medium and the message made sense together. But now I think it's a little bit more mixed up, where you have artists who are very much community activists, who are working in public spaces, in ways that make sense outside of the traditional art realm, art museum realm, and yet you also have museums that are trying to get outside of that constraint as well and working in communities. So
the two that come to mind real quickly, Barbara Kruger, I was at the Stedelijk in Amsterdam, and they gave her a whole room, one of the most famous museums in the world, and it was mind-blowing. Yeah. And then you see the bus, and then Mark Bradford, who's here in Limerick Park, sells his paintings, selling galleries for now millions of dollars, and he's also doing these public things. So these lines,
they've become much more blurred, I think, as museums are much more interested in thinking, or they're realizing, it's not just an epiphany, it is a realization that it's not just about the bricks and mortar of their building, but that, you know, this is about engagement, what's happening digitally, what's happening in communities, what's happening beyond. But then artists as well, you know, realizing that it's a larger playing field in terms of how to connect with people.
Mm-hmm. And this, of course, is part of the larger postmodern sort of breakdown of silos and what we think of as these spaces. You know, my work on hospitals, where is medicine? It's not in a hospital anymore, it's all over the place.
I mean, we have artists working in hospitals commissioning artists now because of a realization that makes a different kind of environment. There's just an article in yesterday's Wall Street Journal about hospitals and their interest in art patrons and how that can possibly affect and change their spaces.
Cedar Sinai has one of the best art collections in LA.
Exactly. There's a very good collection in a hospital in Atlanta that's been built up by a colleague of mine. So, you know, it's very interesting to think about these spaces as usable spaces that are public in a sense, in the sense that people come to them and spend time in them, and how that space is going to be affected by what is put in it, including the art, the furniture, the fabric,